sent for them, they turned away. All except a few of them kept their promise, but the majority abandoned jihad, and Allah has full knowledge of them. So then the same thing happened, and this is mentioned in more detail here. And their prophet said to them, indeed Allah has sent to you Saul as a king. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appointed Talut as the king. وَقَالَ لَهُمْ نَبِيُّهُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ بَعَثَ لَكُمْ تَالُوتَ مَلِكًا قَالُوا أَنَّا يَكُونُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ عَلَيْنَا وَنَحْنُ أَحَقُّ بِالْمُلْكِ مِنْهُ وَلَمْ يُؤْتَ سَعَةً مِنَ الْمَالِ. So basically their point was that how come you make Talut as the king while we have more right over him in terms of the for the kingship, as we have the more wealth than him. So they compared the leadership to how much a wealth a person can have. But what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَزَادَهُ بَسْتَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen him over you and increased in him abundantly in knowledge and stature. So Allah's criteria was the knowledge. Allah's criteria was not the wealth, but the knowledge and the stature. وَاللَّهُ يُؤْتِي مُلْكَهُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَاللَّهُ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. Then Allah gives his sovereignty to whom he wills, and Allah is all-encompassing in favor and knowing. So basically, this is what happened. The Talut was appointed. Talut was not a soldier. He was not even a descendant of the house of kings among them. So there was an exclusive family where the prophethood or the leadership was there, that is the offspring of Yehuda or Judah. But the Talut was also a poor person, and he did not have wealth. So that's why the children of Israel asked this question, how come we can justify that he being a prophet or the leader or the king? Then Prophet Shmuel said that this is not that I have chosen Talut to be your king on my own, rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded that upon your request. Since you asked for it, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen the Talut. And his choice is not based on your choice, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a different criteria. He has chosen the knowledge over the wealth. So that's where Talut was more knowledgeable and honorable than you, and stronger and more patient during combat, and has more knowledge of warfare. So from this ayah, a great lesson we learn is that when the criteria of the leadership is not based on the family from which that person comes, or the how much wealth that person have. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that the criteria for the leadership is that how much knowledgeable that person is, and how much he's knowledgeable about the warfare or the situation which he has to lead, how good he is at that current situation or knowledge of the warfare or leading the people. So knowledge and the strength has been chosen over the wealth. In short, he has more knowledge and he is more stronger than you are. Then the king should have sufficient knowledge and should have a strong soul and body. So that's how the criteria of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was in choosing Talut, which is known as the Saul in biblical stories. Then he was chosen as the leader. So a good majority of the people went with the Talut to fight against the Jalut, was the Goliath, and we will see in the next week in more details. But here the Allah subhanahu the Talut mentions that and their prophet said to them, indeed a sign of his kingship is the chest will come to you in which assurance from your Lord and remnant of what the family of Moses and family of Harun had left, carried by the angels. Indeed, in that is a sign for you if you are believers. So here, after giving that reasoning for why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen Talut over the others, still the children of Israel were not satisfied. So in order to make them satisfied, and it is that's how the children of Israel were, they were used to seeing the miracles and things like that, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the sign is that, you know, the Talut which was lost, that you will be able to recover it. So what was this tabut? Tabut basically had the staff of Musa alayhi salam. It has the remnants of the tablets and the original copy of the Torah, which Musa alayhi salam had it. And then it also has a golden urn or a vase, basically, which holds the man and the salwa. Out of that, salwa is a bird, basically. The man was, their kind of grain, which was given to the children of Israel. That was a sign. And so the tradition was they used to keep these things in one box, which was the tabut. And the tabut was very sacred for them. So whenever they used to travel long distance, they used to make sure that the tabut is in front of them. Whenever there is a warfare, they used to put the tabut in the first row. So it was very, very sacred for them. But when they were attacked by the Amalekites, and when their Palestinian kingdom was lost, they also took this tabut with them. And the Mufassirun has mentioned that when the enemies took their tabut, it so happened that wherever they kept the tabut, that area was having some kind of epidemics, and they thought that all these bad things are happening because of this tabut. And then they decided to let go this tabut, and the way they did was they had an ox cart, and they put the tabut in the cart and let the ox go freely. So that's where the Mufassirun has mentioned that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned here that carried by the angels, that's how the angels directed those cart to come straight to the children of Israel, and the tabut was brought to Talut's house. And so the people believed in the prophethood of Shamoil and also obey Talut. So that's how the sign which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed it to them, so that they accept Talut as their king and then follow the commands of their prophet Shamoil. Then the next part, it is actual the battle or actual journey towards the battle. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَمَّا فَسَلَ تَعْلُوتُ بِالْجُنُودِ قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مُبْتَلِكُمْ بِنَهْرِ فَمَنْ شَرِبَ مِنْهُ فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي وَمَنْ لَمْ يَتْعَمْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي إِلَّا مَنِ غُتَرَفَ غُرْفَةً بِيَدِي. So here, when Talut alayhi salam, he said to the soldiers, he has a big army, he wanted to test his soldiers, and through the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that indeed Allah will be testing you with a river. So whoever drinks from it is not of me, and whoever does not taste it is indeed of me, except one who takes from it in the hollow of his hand. So his test was like, when you're going to cross this river, you're going to just drink little bit of it and not drink a lot of the water. And the Mufassirun has explained in details that this was a river as they were in the current day Jordan. And some of Assyrian has mentioned that it is the Jordan River, and the river has one path towards the south or the north, and one area is shallow and another is deep. So it looks like there is an area of the river where the water is not suitable for drinking. The water is contaminated with so many different kinds of minerals that it is not good for drinking. So Mufassirun mentioned that what would have happened is that when they were going through that river, then Talut asked them not to drink of it, because if you're going to drink, the minerals are going to have its own effect, and then you will not be able to carry on. And a good majority of them actually drank, and then they suffered because of that. So the ayah continues, فَلَمَّا جَاوَزَهُ هُوَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ قَالُوا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا الْيَوْمَ بِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ قَالَ الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا اللَّهِ كَمْ مِنْ فِيَةٍ قَلِيلَةٍ غَلَبَتْ فِيَةً كَثِيرَةً بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. That, but when they drank from it, except a very few of them, then when he had crossed it along with those who believed with him, they said, there is no power for us today against the Goliath and his soldiers. But those who were certain that they would meet, Allah said, how many times it happened that a small company has overcome a large company by permission of Allah, and Allah is with the patient. So basically, in this one ayah, several things have been mentioned. So as I mentioned, the first incident took place, which is about the the river, the test of the river. So the originally they had about 80,000 soldiers with them. Then when they crossed this river, then very few left with them. Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu commented that whoever took some of it, the river's water, in the hollow of his hand, quenched his thirst. As for those who drank freely from it, their thirst was not quenched. And that's the logical reasoning could be that the minerals they had, and because of that they were not able to carry on. Then the next test was when only few of them were able to cross the river. And as this narration states that Al-Bara bin Azib, it is mentioned in Ibn Kathir, said that we used to say that the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam who accompanied him on the Battle of Badr were more than 310, just as many as the soldiers who crossed the river with Talut. Only those who believed crossed the river with him. So there is great similarities between the Battle of Badr and this battle which took place between the Talut and the Jalut, and where Dawud alayhi salam killed the Jalut. So here, according to this narration, out of those 80,000 or a big army, only few hundreds were left when they reached the other army in the battlefield. So when they came, obviously it was natural, looking at these huge numbers, the second test happened, which was the test of the believers. They said, you know, now we cannot fight. We don't have that much energy and capacity to take up this. So, but among them, there were knowledgeable people then who said this, we don't win by the numbers or by the supplies or things like that, but the victory comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's where this very famous part of the ayah, where how often has a small group overcome a mighty host by Allah's leave, and Allah is with patient. So inshallah, I think this is the last ayah for today, but this thing will continue in the next week, inshallah. وَلَمَّا بَرَزُوا لِجَالُوتَ وَجُنُودِهِ قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And hence the believers, they made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبَّنَا أَفْرِغْ عَلَيْنَا صَبْرًا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send down them the patience on us, and then that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep them steadfast and save them from running away from the battlefield. So basically, this, as I mentioned in summary, these ayahs were revealed just before the Battle of Badr. And then if you look at these two great nations, one is the nation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the nation of Musa alaihi wasallam, there are a lot of similarities between those two ummas. And as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, you know, whatever the children of Israel have done, gone through, you will go through the same way. So you will see a lot of similarities between these two ummah and this, the Battle of Badr, which was about to happen, and this incident about the battle between the Talut and the Jalut. It is also the golden period for the children of Israel, that after this battle they were able to establish the kingdom, where Talut became the king, and then followed by Dawud alayhi salam and the Sulaiman alayhi salam. So I think with that I'll stop here, inshallah. If we have any